The following is a presentation of WON Sports.
You're listening to XFL Now on the Alternative Football News Network and WON Sports. Nick Anthony, Kevin Drake, and Michael Washington Weeks. XFL Now.
Well, hello, everybody. Thank you, Mr. Announcer Man. Nick Anthony, Kevin Drake, Michael Washington Weeks. This is XFL Now at 310-876-8064. 310-876-8064. AFNTalk.com, WN Sports. How the hell are you? All across social media at AFN Talk. Weekly, we will be running down everything from XFL, from the CEO to the groundskeeper and everything in between. Stream us live, of course, but you can also download, upload, left load, or right load us as well. Speaking of loads, our producer, Harry the Booze, Bob, you have an issue with anything we bring up on the show, you can park it at his doorstop. this week.
Sorry.
This week on the program. Oh man. What are we doing? What are we doing? I don't know what we're doing. All right.
I have no idea.
All right. Let's put the train back on the tracks. Let's just blame Harry for that. Thanks, Harry. This week on the program, Mike. NFL or XFL? That's the question. Trent Richardson's been in the news this past week. He has a decision to make, a huge decision. NFL or XFL? In an interview with the Pensacola News Journal, Trent said, "I've gotten a few phone calls, but you never know about the NFL. Hopefully I put enough out there to show I can still move and play. I'm doing this for myself and my kids." Trent continues by saying, "A lot of people have been calling me. The XFL has been calling me. The NFL has been calling me. The opportunity is there. And if the NFL doesn't come through, then definitely XFL." And it got me to thinking, fellas. We know the NFL has the money, and it draws. There's no guessing on that part. However, as Trent brought up about the NFL, you never really know about that league and the higher-ups with the court of public opinion, you know, and the face that the NFL tries to portray. They have enough money to throw Trent's way, but what league, NFL or XFL, benefits the stock of Trent Richardson more? Certainly in the XFL, Trent would stand out more, wouldn't he? As a star player, a franchise player, a face for that league, the XFL, a name that football fans know, maybe not his face, but certainly his name, Trent Richardson, we all know that. He could be that player that some team in the XFL needs to draw fans. So my question, what league, NFL or XFL, benefits the stock of Trent Richardson more? Does he potentially get lost in an NFL shuffle or the face of a league in the XFL? The huge payday in the NFL or potential endorsements and superstardom from the XFL, because he won't get that from the NFL. It's a hell of a decision to have to make for Trent. And for me personally, Mike, I think I'm going XFL for Trent Richardson if I'm him.
Yeah, I am too. And I think the biggest reason that we have to – the other reasons we have to factor into this is he's 29 years old. He didn't have much success in the NFL when he was there. He had 1 year where he was really good. That was his rookie year. And after that, it just he's a who's who of running backs. His resurface with the AAF, the defunct league that's, you know, this past spring, and it was a little bit of a slow start for him. You know, he led the league in touchdowns, but he only averaged 2.5 yards a carry. So that progressed and got better as the year went on. We don't know where it would have ended if the season had continued. The XFL style of play might benefit him a little bit better than the NFL play. And like you mentioned, you know, a bigger payday in the NFL with the contract, but he's not going to get the same endorsements that he would get if he landed like at XFL St. Louis, XFL Tampa Bay, or any of the other XFL franchises and was a star running back there. I mean, the endorsements are going to be probably just, you know, will probably not necessarily balance it out on the same scale, but he's going to get veteran minimum at the NFL level, or he could become one of the tier one players at the XFL level, play for three more years and help himself as far as get a payday and endorsements is concerned and try to rebuild himself and show that he can still play. It just may not be at the NFL level.
Does he make that? If he chooses the XFL, is he starting? Is he a starter? Or XFL still hold the NFL cuts as, you know, number one draft picks or starting for a particular team or not?
Well, this is going to be a weird comparison, and the reason there's a reason for it. The XFL is going to have to do something similar to when the WNBA started. Hmm. When the WNBA started, it was a lot of the older players that we knew from college that, you know, they were successful. They were household names because the women's college basketball draws. But they were all older at that point in time. So the game pace was a little bit slower. You know, the play style wasn't as fast paced as college. And when they started pumping in some of that new blood, that's when we really started seeing the WNBA move faster. The gameplay started, and then they started making money. The XFL is going to have to be similar to that. We're going to see a lot of the older players, you know, Trent Richardson at 29. You know, we talked about Jonas Gray last year at 30, not necessarily a guy that's a household name, but somebody that, you know, some people do know who he is. So Richardson will definitely be a starter. It will be for at least a year or two before the XFL can start pumping in some of the new blood. Mm-hmm. Because make no mistake about it, with the XFL not having that age restriction to be able to be eligible to play for them, they're going to see 18, 19, 20 year olds come out of college early to play for them, especially if it succeeds.
Well, see, that makes sense. That makes a whole hell of a lot. And certainly, wouldn't you take a young college up and comer or even a cut from the NFL over a Trent Richardson? I kind of would. And like you said, 2.5 carries. You know, what was his stats for AAF? 300.
He ended with like a 2.8 yard per carry average, but it was 2.5 for the first like five games of the year.
Yeah. So when that materializes in NFL, does he stick around? Does NFL or a particular team in NFL say, okay, we've had enough? And does XFL allow him to come back or allow him to enter the league after pretty much snubbing him for the NFL?
Well, I don't know what the XFL dynamics are. I'm assuming that they would probably open him, open up the doors for him, even if he went to the NFL and then got cut.
Yeah.
But the thing with Trent is if he was to go to the NFL, I mean, I'm looking down a list of teams in the NFL and I'm looking at running back situations and looking at the running back talent that's there. And at 29, even though Trent Richardson can offer short yardage back potential, essentially, he's not going to be any more effective than a guy like LeGarrette Blount.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's literally his ceiling at the NFL level. If he goes to the XFL and has a chance to showcase that he still has it, you know, if the offensive line plays better than what it was in the AAF, you know, there's various factors that went into his 2.5-yard rushing per carry at Birmingham. But if for some chance he starts hitting on all cylinders and averages 3.8, 3.9 yards a carry, he can become a star in the XFL, but it's going to be very short lived because of the age factor involving with this. Cause everybody knows running backs, the ceiling is 30 to 31 years old with a few anomalies in there. But for the most part, 30, 31, that's when you start really seeing the regression.
And also remember this, in NFL, the D-line is bigger, stronger, faster, you know, more powerful than probably anything you're going to have on the XFL level. Otherwise, they'll be in the NFL, true?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And I think that's going to be where the things are going to start with the XFL is you're going to see a lot of guys that necessarily didn't. I mean, we know for a fact we're going to see guys that didn't make NFL rosters. That's going to make up a majority of their team.
Yeah.
Eventually, though, like I mentioned with the Trent Richardson situation in the comparisons, you know, those 18, 19, 20 year olds, some of those guys that may not want to play for college and not get paid, you know, to play there and risk season, possibly career ending injuries. I mean, Marcus Lattimore comes to mind, two devastating knee injuries really ended his career, and he could have been a star running back in the NFL. They might want to take the money and go play at the XFL. And then you might start seeing the quality of player creep up. I mean, that's going to be obviously over the period of time. I mean, Trent for the 3-year window will definitely benefit from not having to play those NFL caliber guys.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you and I both are, I think we're on the same page. We would go XFL. That benefits our stock more. But you let us know, 310-876-8064. That is the telephone number. All across social media at afntalk.com. Which league benefits Trent Richardson's stock more? Does he take the huge payday from the NFL that potentially will burn his body down quicker? Even if he does play, we don't even know if he will play with the current talent that's moving up to the NFL and some of the stronger talents than Trent Richardson. Will he even play? He's going to be a backup. I don't think he'll start in the NFL. Do you?
No, he wouldn't start in the NFL. The only thing he would be filler. He would be a depth guy, a guy to provide some solidarity behind the starters or second guys. Chances are he would get cut. I mean, camps have already started. He hasn't signed yet.
Yeah.
He would be behind the learning, you know, the eight ball with the learning curve as far as the teams are concerned. I couldn't see him unless he went into a system that was similarly ran to the Cleveland Browns system his rookie year.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't see him just jumping in on one of these offenses and making a name for himself right off the jump like that. He would probably end up being cut. He'd probably be a late cut, but he'd get cut.
Yeah, XFL is definitely more beneficial for the Richardson stock. I mean, he'll be an instant star instantly. Yeah, he'll get the endorsements. He'll get people talking about it. He'll be in all the papers, articles, the sites, in other words. He'll be on every news channel, a sporting news channel, because he is the name. He is that face of the XFL at this point. I mean, even now, we're talking about him. Everyone's talking about him. He's on every XFL post. He's on every XFL news article. Trent Richardson, Trent Richardson, Trent Richardson, NFL or XFL. So he has that stardom. He has that face power. He has that look already. Why not continue it and get a huge endorsement, get the favorite of the XFL and be the face of that league? It's pretty much common sense, in my opinion.
Yeah, the only thing that the NFL would provide for him would be like a 3-day buzz of a feel-good story.
And the money.
Right. Well, I mean, because
he's
money,
not,
but as
he's
far
not
as
getting, he's not getting a huge payday working with the XFL. I don't even know what the base salary is, but it is.
Well, he's not getting a huge payday with the NFL either, though, because he would probably get a veteran minimum, which is not much higher than the top tier for the XFL.
Well, it's significantly lower. XFL did it. From what?
They're both six figures.
Is it?
Yeah. The league minimum for a veteran is six figures.
Okay. All right. Well, yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, they're both a six-figure window. I mean, one is definitely – the XFL one is definitely smaller than the NFL
of course.
But if he gets cut and doesn't play for the XFL, he's not making any money. So, what does it matter anyways?
All right, you're in the XFL office. You're one of the higher-ups under Oliver Luck. You're not Oliver Luck, but you're one of his stooges, okay? And Trent Richardson's just been cut from the NFL for performance issues or what have you. He's just not cutting it. Do you say, hey, we got Trent Richardson, we open him up for our league, what team wants him, let's sign him up?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the thing with Trent Richardson is he is a talented running back. He was a talented running back at Alabama. He showed that he could run in the NFL back with Cleveland. There were some issues with vision, but overall, it's not like he was a guy who wasn't a high-round draft pick who didn't have talent.
Mm-hmm.
It just the NFL game might have just been too much for him, and then Cleveland shot his confidence by trading him, and then Indianapolis tried force feeding him the offense, you know, to the point where all pro wide receiver Reggie Wayne was even like, you know, they're like force feeding him this offensive playbook, and it's just too much for a young kid like that. So I just think overall it was his confidence. I think he got in his own head. He couldn't get out of it, and he just never really rebounded from it. He had a chance in the AAF. He didn't get benched in the AAF, even though he was, you know, 2.5 in a cloud of dust. So he was doing stuff enough to be able to remain a starter. I guess it would depend. I mean, it depends on what the XFL was looking at, but cuts are early enough that if he did go to the NFL, play in the preseason, and then get cut, I would definitely still open the doors for him just to give him an opportunity and chance.
310-876-8064, all across social media, afntalk.com, WN Sports as well. Trent Richardson, beneficial in XFL or NFL?
We'll return with more of XFL Now.
Is open daily. Ride the wave into cool summertime family fun. From the lazy lagoon to the dragon slide, the new wave pool to the dive of the avalanche, there's something for everyone. Purchase your season pass now for only $63.95. Includes daily admission, locker and tube discounts, special meal deals, and one free day pass. Order online at waterworkspark.com.
Your summertime happy place is
Waterworks Park,
the coolest place in Redding.
My name's James. For 6 years, I was a garbage can druggie. I would do any kind of drug I would get my hands on. But here at Teen Challenge, I've walked away from that drug lifestyle for good.
If you know an adult or teenager who is struggling with a chemical addiction, Teen Challenge is there to help. Please, don't wait. Call us today at 417-862-6969 or reach us on the web at teenchallengeusa.com.
Canadian Aquatic Auctions, the place to be if you are into anything aquatic. Nelson Fletcher, owner and operator, has years of experience and wants to help you better achieve your aquatic needs and goals. So if you're an aquatic hobbyist and enthusiast, please visit Canadian Aquatic Auctions today. Their public auctions provide a venue to remarket all aquatic-related products, services, and equipment. If you are just starting out in the hobby, the site has a tack room where you can converse with other aquatic hobbyists like yourself. Canadian Aquatic Auctions is the eBay of everything aquatic. So visit Nelson at his site at www.aquariumauctions.ca or go check out his Facebook page as well at www.facebook.com/Canadian Aquatic Sales. Together we can build lasting relationships that are based on listening and servicing your needs in a professional environment. Canadian Aquatic Auctions.
XFL Now.
Oh, God. Whoa. Looking at your last text. Damn, did you even really mean it? Did you even look through it? Did you even read it? What? I've been breaking up with girls since I was 15. It's the only thing that hasn't got easier. Whoa. Where's the only thing that ever came between us?
James in Los Angeles writes in, Trent, look, head to the XFL. Don't chase the money. Eventually, you'll be cut. So there you go. I absolutely agree, Mike. Eventually, he will get cut because he won't be able to keep up. You mentioned it earlier. At his age of 29, he's going to begin the breakdown. The D-line is stronger, faster, bigger. They're going to be hitting harder. And when your body starts to break down, you begin the breakdown, it's over. Go to the XFL. Get your stardom. Get your endorsements. And live a happy life there, being the face of that league. I'm Nick Anthony. All right. 310-876-8064 is the telephone number. You agree with James in L.A.?
I do. I think that, you know, Trent Richardson's realistically looking at a 2 to 3 year window to really bounce back. And the XFL is going to provide that opportunity. I mean, $750 million already put into this league. Vince McMahon's serious. Oliver Luck's there. This gives him a chance to be that star, you know, even if it is for a two to three year gap. And, you know, chasing the money is one thing, but, you know, what you don't make in the NFL where you have a very high, you know, potential of getting cut, you can make up for endorsements through the XFL because they're going to be out in the communities. They've already proved it. We spoke about it earlier on one of our other shows. Mm-hmm. They're out in the communities already. And this will give him an opportunity to get out there, get his name, get the endorsement deals to make up that difference for what he's not making from the NFL yep. in the XFL. Go do it. Two to three years. Go be a star, Trent. Come to the XFL.
Yep. Name and on every site, every news story, every commercial, everything. He'll get the endorsements, period. He's a name. And like I said, may not know his face because he's in a damn helmet every week, but we may not know his face, but we know the name Trent Richardson. Period.
And it would be good for the XFL too. Because it would be a good feel-good story, mm-hmm. something the XFL can have for a positive news coverage of Trent Richardson bouncing back and becoming a star, but in the XFL. That's a great story for the XFL as well. So I think that come to the XFL, Trent.
And
just
also
stop playing games.
Yeah, stop playing games. And also, when you think about it, when Trent chooses the XFL over the NFL, what does that say about the NFL to fans? Oh, look, Trent went over to the XFL. Maybe we should start watching the XFL. What does Trent know that we don't know about the NFL? Let's go over there and give them a chance, right?
Well, I don't think it will be as big of an impact. Uh-huh. I think it would definitely bring eyes to it, but I don't think it would be as big of an impact unless it was something, somebody like, say, a Will Fuller of the Houston Texans, or somebody that's currently in the NFL now that's like, you know what, I'm just going to let my contract run out and I'm going to go play for the XFL. Yeah. Okay. Mainly because of the fact that this is something that a lot of NFL fans don't view Trent Richardson as really much of anything anymore. You know, they feel a bust, a bum, you know.
Right.
You know, not a good running back type of situation. So I don't think that Trent Richardson saying, I'm going to take the XFL, is going to turn too many heads. I think it will turn enough Bama fans, you know, T Rich believers from when he was in Cleveland.
But I don't know if it's fair. I don't know if it's fair for you to say that the fans believe that he's a bust or just lackluster, running back, because the NFL came calling, dude. So I don't know if that's fair to even say.
Yeah, but I mean, they call everybody in the off season. I mean, they have 96 man rosters.
They didn't call you, and they didn't call me. So it's not
I don't
everybody.
Play running back. I'm too fat for that. So
all right, O line. They didn't call you for the O line either. So
I'm not big enough for the O line. Right, I'm just out of shape.
Sorry to hear that.
I mean, rounds of shape, but I mean.
this past week here in L.A., dude. The president of the XFL Los Angeles team, Heather Karatz or Carrots, and
I think it's Karatz.
Many other presidents from the cities where their teams are from, they attended the NFL training camps. Now, we know currently NFL franchises will need to cut teams down. You just mentioned it. They call everybody. There's 90 people on a roster. They got to cut down to the 40 or 50 or whatever the hell they need to cut it down to, right? They need to cut it from their roster. Well, those guys will be funneled to the XFL potentially, and I'm assuming, you know, they're going to be starters on the field. With Heather and other presidents going to the NFL training camps this past week in their cities, could this be potentially scouting or individuals going out to check out NFL talents in hopes or knowing, I'll say it that way, knowing of cuts already by NFL teams and hopefully getting them to come to the XFL?
Yeah, I think that their primary objective here is obviously scouting players, but I look at it a little bit differently, too. I wonder if they're also looking at practice habits and looking at the way that practices are structured in the NFL and giving them an opportunity and chance to see how training camps are run. I know that they have a lot of experience with a lot of the coaches and stuff there, and I'm sure a lot of these coaches know what a training camp looks like and stuff. But with the XFL play style being so different, I'm wondering if they're doing a little bit of both. If they're scouting the players, but they're also looking at, okay, this works here in the NFL. I don't think this will work for us. Maybe we can structure our practices a little bit different to get the most beneficial or the biggest return on investment with these players. Because that's one of the toughest things, is trying to find a training camp regimen that works for a lot of players. You can have all the talent in the world, but if you don't have a training camp and practice schedules that fit with each individual person or fit as a whole with a team, you can't really get a maximum effort or a maximum return on investment with certain people. So I think there might be a combination of possibly what they're doing, because it would be smart for them to say, okay, this works in the NFL, but it may not work here in the XFL, or, oh, that looks like it could work here in the XFL. Let's borrow or adopt that idea and kind of mold it into our own.
When we come back, Michael Mitchell is going to be a guest on the program. He is a staff writer, reporter for XFLboard.com. He's going to be joining us on the program. We'll talk about this and much more on the XFL. That's when we come back here on XFL. Now, the telephone number, we're still taking your phone calls at 310-876-8064. Mike Mitchell, when we come back.
XFL Now.
Have you ever dreamed of becoming a professional wrestler? Then what are you waiting for? Join the PCW Work Farm now! Quality instructors, live monthly shows, classes every Wednesdays and Sundays, and with the most affordable rates in the United States, PCW has been Northern California's number one force in sports entertainment for the last 17 years. Pro Championship Wrestling, because it's time!
Ski's Watch and Clock, 106 West Central Avenue, Winter Haven, Florida, 33880. Located downtown across from the main post office. When you're short on time, he's right on time. For all of your watch, clock, sales, and service needs, call Ski's, 863-294-5630. Sales, service, free estimates, and reasonable rate. That's 863-294-5630. For Ski's Watch and Clock.
XFL Now.
All right, Michael Mitchell, staff writer, reporter for XFLboard.com, joins us on the program now at MMXFLBoard on Twitter. Mike Mitchell, hello, man. How are you? Who's Mike, you've been following the XFL from its infancy, dude. All we need to know about rules and regulations as of now. Welcome to the program, dude. What rule change stands out the most in this new XFL that has you intrigued?
Well, thank you very much for having me on. I think the thing that has me most intrigued is the all 11 audio communication system between the coaches and all the players that are on the field. I think that has a chance to be something that's going to be a part of pro and college football down the road. Mm-hmm. I think that's an innovation there. That's going to speed up the game significantly, because it's pretty much going to end the need for a huddle. And so when basically every player is going to know what the play call is immediately after a play is over. So, and on the flip side, defensive players are all going to know where they need to line up and what the call is immediately. They're going to have to need to know it, because the offense is going to have a clear advantage in that case. If you have the head coach telling the quarterback at the line of scrimmage, look at the safety, he's shading over to one side of the field, go to the tight end, their quarterback's job is going to be much easier if his coach is in his headset telling them what to do. It's almost the equivalent of us watching Tony Romo call games on CBS and him basically predicting where the ball is going to go to line of scrimmage. Now, just imagine the fans at home or in the stadium, which that would be crazy, but being able to hear that communication at the line of scrimmage. I think that's going to speed up the game significantly. That's an innovation that I know that's been tested out with the Spring League over the course of the last few days. So, whether or not they can pull that off remains to be seen. That costs a lot of money.
Yeah.
And it's not as easy as it sounds, because of the simple fact that even when you watch an NFL game, there are headset issues. Sometimes it's a competitive advantage where the road team's headsets kind of wink, wink, go out.
Right.
But I think pulling that off, if ESPN, ABC, and Fox can pull that off, that's an innovation that is ahead of its time.
So let me ask you this, brother, and I really know nothing about it. I quite frankly. I'm just going to be completely honest and not lie about sure. it. When you have guys with audio in their head and a coach on the sideline is saying, go left, go left, go left, go right, go right, go right, can't that be a little confusing as a player?
I'm sorry to interrupt you. Not necessarily. Basically, the way the operation works now is, you know this, but the head coach will relay the play into the quarterback, and then the audio gets cut off. The NFL cuts off the audio. I want to say it's within a 15-second time frame before the snap takes place.
Uh-huh.
So what happens is the quarterback gets the call and then relays it to the player.
Right.
So all these players in the NFL and college football and football leagues, they know what the call is and they know what they're supposed to do. It can be a simple sentence. It could be red X banana. And everybody on the field knows what they're supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, that's how the football is set up. Otherwise, you'd be sitting there for an hour calling in a play to the quarterback and say, okay, wide receiver on the outside, he's doing a curl. Wide receiver in the slot is doing a hook, you know, that kind of thing. So basically what it would do is everybody would hear the play. So if it's, say, red X banana, for example, everyone on the field will know, okay, that's what we're doing next. And they're on there. You see a little bit of that in college. They do signals sometimes. I don't know how often you guys watch college games.
Yeah, with the big signs on the sideline, yeah.
Everyone knows. It could be a picture of an orange.
Right.
And everyone on offense knows exactly what the play call is and what they're supposed to be doing. That's the whole preparation before a game, weeks leading in. Everyone knows it. So if everyone on the field knows it instantly, you're going to be able to line up quicker. I think I heard you guys at the opening of the show, you were talking about Trent Richardson, and it was a good point. He certainly has name value, and the XFL is certainly an option for him, no mm-hmm. question about it. But one big thing that's going to be a factor in the XFL, the way they're constructing the game rules, is conditioning. So if you can get away with the older quarterback. That might be helpful, somebody who's mm-hmm. experienced veteran. Mm-hmm. But you can't have too many older players playing in this up-tempo game. Conditioning is going to be a big factor in the XFL. I'm not trying to say that they're going to have, because the NFL has the best football players on the planet. But if you're playing a 25-second play clock and you're rushing through the entire game, you're going to need athletic offensive linemen, defensive linemen. You can't have big backs huffing and puffing. No disrespect to Trent Richardson.
Well,
and not being able to keep up.
Well, at the same note, at 29, 30, I think he just turned 29 in July 10th or whatever the hell right. it was. I mean, it's only going to be a few more years that his body can even hold up playing in the NFL, let alone the XFL. I don't see him in the NFL. Either.
No, I don't. You know, the NFL, he would have to be in a situation where he's like C.J. Anderson last year with the Rams, where he comes off the street, basically, fresh legs, and helps supplant Todd Gurley. There was a nice little stretch there for the Rams where he was very helpful. Richardson would have to be that, like, power back mm-hmm. who basically comes in for a workout during the season, helps replace and plays a role, like you guys mentioned, LeGarrette Blount, obviously. Richardson wouldn't command big money. Obviously, the veteran minimum is somewhere in that 800,000 to million range, depending on how many years you've accrued in the NFL.
Yeah.
So I don't know, you know, whether or not in the XFL, the way the structure is, at least at the moment, the top paying players are going to make 250K plus. You're going to get activation bonuses for every game that you're active and mm-hmm. win bonuses. So you could make up to, say, 600,000. And then there is the factor that you guys mentioned as far as sponsorships go. So you can weigh both of those things. If I was Trent,
yeah, I was going to ask you that.
I would consider playing in the XFL because, I would consider playing. But the question is with Trent, see, he in the AAF, his salary was only 70K per season. That was the max. From the long snapper to the quarterback, every player in the alliance made $70,000 a year.
Mm-hmm. That was ridiculous.
Yeah, that is ridiculous. So that's how you get that level of play where the long snapper is making the same money as Garrett Gilbert. But anyway, that's another story for another time.
Yeah.
But as far as the XFL goes, the way it's currently possibly constructed is that 8 players would make 250 and above. The second tier would be 24 players throughout the league, 3 per team, where they would make from 100K to 200K per season. Now, that's probably the spot where Trent Richardson would fit in if he's considered a second-tier player by the XFL's football operations department. That's right. up to the scouting department of the XFL, whether or not they see him as that type of player. But he could certainly make more money than he was making in the alliance, that's for sure.
Let's stick with money. Mike, by the way, staff writer, reporter for XFL board, Mike Mitchell, joining us here on XFL Now, AFN Talk, WON Sports. The league at its current state has money. It's WWE money, nonetheless. So I'm suggesting, in order to generate money for, you know, your headsets, the Trent Richardsons of the world, those top tier, top one, and the bottom tiers, to pay these guys, in other words, does Vince eventually sell franchises to individuals, or could we possibly see Alpha go public to bring in some dough?
You know, that's a fun conversation, because if that ever happens, that means the XFL survives past a year or two. Because, you know, as much of a follower and a supporter as I am of the league, you got to go into this with some level of skepticism. So you hope that the XFL can get to year two and three. And I do think that that's the idea going forward. They won't say that publicly right now, but you got to remember Oliver Luck is the CEO and the commissioner of the league. And I think they have a MLS vision with the XFL, where, if you know, MLS was a single entity, and then they started selling off as they started becoming more and more successful. They started selling off franchises, and now MLS is a success, no question about it.
Yeah,
from a financial standpoint, and all that. So I think there could be. That's a happy question, because if they ever get to that point, that means they're still around, and let's hope that they are.
And honestly, when you think about it, and I know the AAF had had separate issues, but the league owned their teams, right?
Yeah, that was single entity as well. Yeah,
I think selling franchises bring in money, because that allows individuals, franchise owners, to have a payroll themselves and not take money from the league. So they're also paying the league a fee to be in the league. That's generating money. And they're out making their own sales, getting their own endorsements, and then still paying the league to be within the league. I think it helps business grow for the XFL.
Sure, that's a good point. But here's one thing you got to remember with that. And as we saw with the Alliance, getting quality ownership, that's not as easy as it sounds. Because you saw with the AAF, their first owner was Reggie Fowler, who attempted to be an NFL owner way back when with the Minnesota Vikings. And then you had Tom Dundon, who bailed out the USFL. I know that's going back quite a ways. But they had a couple of good owners, but most of their owners were horrible. If you look up the history of the USFL, they couldn't pay their players. Players were going to the owners' houses and with guns demanding payroll.
Oh, geez.
I mean, guys were hiring USFL. You can read what's the name? Perlman's book on the USFL. I mean, there were some crazy stories. There was one of the owners, I think, for the Houston Gamblers actually had one of their farmhands be puncher for the team, because he couldn't afford to pay payroll. So you need to have it's pretty bad. Jeff Perlman's book on the USFL, I'm trying to remember the name of it. It's escaping me at the moment, but it's a great read on the USFL. There were some great franchises in that league, but one of the things that brought that league down, I know everybody talks about Trump, and that was certainly a factor, but was ownership. Was poor ownership, because when you have a league with eight teams, you got to have eight solid owners. Now, if the AAF tried that, they couldn't even have one solid owner. If the AAF tried to have eight, that could have been problematic. So you need to get to the point where, and Oliver Luck has obviously had a success in a lot of different fields and leagues. You want to get to the point where you actually do the proper vetting and get good owners on board.
There were there was a number of individuals that were looking for NFL teams. I wasn't Sting at one point, the rocker. He was looking for a franchise at one point, wasn't he? If I can remember.
Oh yeah, those type of ownerships though are the what was
sketchy
like diamonds. It's like when you're trying
minority usually.
Yeah. Well, or if it's an NFL franchise, that's more of what you would call a diamond stock, in that you're guaranteed money as soon as you have ownership. So you usually have an ownership group that is pretty solid. And so when it comes to like a startup league, when you're trying to round up random millionaires all over the place, those guys, they don't have the kind of the track record as someone who's making a $1 billion investment in an NFL franchise is someone that knows he's going to get a good part of that money back. They already have money built in. So that's a different story for another time, but they certainly the XFL, the ownership model, that's something for the future. That the league has to show that it's profitable and viable before they get to that point.
Well, and this leads me to my next question, which is kind of like a two-part question, honestly. Discussing owners and discussing the success rate of the league, Vince McMahon has registered domain names for several for a lot of cities outside of the eight that he's already announced. Sure. Is it possible that underneath Alpha Entertainment, that the goal is eventually to franchise out these teams? But at what point? Is it 8 teams? Is it 12 teams? Is it 16 teams? And how many years before he finally does that? Because we know Vince is a control freak from his from the WWE days and how he runs that business. And I'm not saying that he's necessarily going to approach Alpha Entertainment the same way. But with all these domain names being registered already and knowing Vince's, you know, hunger for a successful football league, where would the cutoff be for teams for the franchise? And is it more of a long-term plan, like a 10-year plan, or is it something like a 3-year plan?
I think, honestly, in order for the league to consider expansion and in the second year, they would basically have to be so successful in year one. And then I do think if there was expansion or if there was franchising out franchises, that you would see the addition of 2 to 4 teams initially. So, and then if you get to year 3, year 4, year 5, you can expand upon that. Eventually, I think they would like to. They'll not say, they won't say this publicly, but they would like to get to 16 teams. But they're trying to get to year one and trying to complete year one in good shape. So they're when they get to year two, they can actually start to entertain these options. I think it would be minimal at best. If we saw expansion, perhaps in year two, that would be contingent upon how successful the league is. If they have good ratings in year one, good attendance, and importantly, get good ratings from markets that are not currently XFL markets, that might be an indicator to the league of where they should go. As far as those trademarks that you mentioned, the domain sites and all that, they had 30 different cities that they were considering, and then it got brought down to that list. I think it was like 21 names or what have you, just off the top of my head. I know Atlanta was in there, a few other cities.
Yeah.
But so I think those are definitely consideration for the future. I think also this is like a little extra here. When that was done, the AAF was in existence. I think the AAF with San Antonio and the success of San Diego, maybe even potentially Orlando, I think those cities are now in play because the alliance is no more.
So yeah,
you might see those cities be a part of any potential expansion down the road.
Yeah, I would agree with you, and I think that the four teams that the top four teams out of the AAF, I would include Birmingham in there too. Alabama, Birmingham's is a place that's been calling for a professional team, and I think that it's better suited for an XFL than it is, you know, really an NFL type.
Sure, I've been a supporter of Birmingham for quite some time now. For whatever reason, they've not had a lot of success in these alternate leagues. They did okay in the AAF. They had some attendance issues, mostly due to weather. I know they've got a new facility there in Birmingham. Alabama, every single league, including the NFL, tried Birmingham, and they failed with it with the World League of American Football many moons ago. So Birmingham would definitely be a consideration, no question about it. For whatever reason, though, they've kind of – it's not a major league market. It's major league in terms of football when it comes to college football, but it hasn't succeeded in terms of – you know, business-wise. You know, you would figure Birmingham would be starving for a team, but then you'd sit there and you'd watch an Alliance game and they only got 9,000 fans in attendance or 10,000 fans in attendance. And I think the XFL is actually looking for bigger markets, to be quite frank. So, I mean, maybe Birmingham could make a good pitch. They got a new stadium. They got all that. Maybe it can finally work out for them, but it really hasn't in the past.
Staff writer, reporter from XFLBoard.com, Mike Mitchell, joining us here on XFL Now, AFNTalk.com, WON Sports. Mike, some football fans, whether XFL or NFL, or we'll just call them football fans, that are on social media, just last week were lashing out at the league over team names and logos and colors. You think that's a big deal or not?
You know, I enjoyed the – I'm glad you brought that up. I enjoyed the opener of your show last week where you guys went on what I thought was a justified rant against some of the overly critical followers of the XFL who are so riled up right now that the team identities have not been delivered yet. Yeah. I will say this, though. I understand some of the anxiety and hysteria that is attached to the issue. There's a fair amount of skepticism when it comes to the XFL. And even though the league has done a great job in methodically putting everything together to this point, until the team identities are revealed, the XFL won't appear as if it's actually happening. The release of the team identities is almost for some like a true launching point of the league. And to those people, it's what will make the XFL a reality in their mind. So I kind of understand it. I do think that people went overboard and are still going overboard as I speak. There's probably people out there posting right now that they're upset that the names haven't been released yet. But I think some people are overlooking a few different things with it. I know that they expected July and we're approaching August tomorrow. But I think there are two big factors. I think the league already has the names. I think the issue right now is creative and the legal process. The last thing the league wants to do is release names and then have a bunch of cease and desist letters from different companies saying that the XFL is infringing on their logos. You don't want to spend 2-3 months or more in the court system fighting opposing companies. That's one of the things people have to factor into this is the legal process, because you want, when you release the names, you want to be able to profit off the brands and profit off the names. Yeah. And you don't want to sit there and have to change a name 3 months in or change an identity 3 months in or be in the courts battling it out. So when the league is ready, they will post the trademarks and announce all the team names, team identities at the same time. I understand the hysteria and anxiety attached to it because as an XFL supporter, I can't wait for it. But we're going to get it. I mean, there's not going to be a secret reveal 5 minutes before kickoff. So we are going to get
that.
and that's the other thing too, is I personally feel like that it would be a smart idea for them to split up the uniform reveal and the team names and logos. I think the uniform reveal would be a perfect day, would be the first draft in October.
Oh, that's excellent. Yeah, you know, that's one other thing people, what we're going to get is once we get the team identities, people are going to say, hey, what are the uniforms? Mm-hmm. Well, the first part about that is that the league actually has to have an outfitter under payroll that's making the uniforms. So I think that's a good idea. You know, I think what the XFL is going to try to do, though, is I don't think they want to do the Alliance version. The Alliance released their names in September before their season. And then the uniforms were sometime thereafter. I want to say late November, early December.
All right.
Think what they want to do is release all the identities at the same time. Mm-hmm. And then the uniforms, like you mentioned, you have to figure that they would have to have the uniforms available by the time the draft rolls around. So that sounds plausible. It sounds like a reasonable idea there to have the uniforms come out. This way you have players to put them on.
Yeah,
and
they can
be part of the draft.
Yeah, so they can post pictures with their uniform, you know, as they normally do.
Makes complete sense. So I'm with you guys on that for sure. I'm with you.
Staff writer, reporter, XFLboard.com, Mike Mitchell. One more question for you, and then we'll have some fun a little bit. As a fan of football, you believe the XFL dude will fill that void left after the Super Bowl in the spring?
I think it can, for sure. I think to the Alliance's credit, and they had a lot of problems. As a diehard football fan, I love all leagues, by the way. I love the fact that your network covers all the different indoor leagues and CFL and leagues out there. So I think it can, for the diehard football fan, for sure. And I think if the XFL puts out a quality product, I think people are going to love it. I think there are people that were heartbroken when the Alliance folded and they were really getting into it. It was a startup, so it was going to have a bunch of stutter steps and hiccups in the road. I think the quality of football wasn't bad, and I think it had a chance to build an audience. You can't expect a startup league, though, to be on the level of established leagues like the NFL or MLB or NHL or anything like that. So there's going to be some growing pains, but I do think, as a football fan myself, someone who loves football, I think it can still avoid. It's all contingent upon the quality of the product that's presented by the XFL. I think they're heading there. We'll see how it goes.
All right. Mike Mitchell, staff writer, reporter for XFL Board. We're going to do Weeks on the Week and a little pop quiz. So get your Twitter twos ready. When we come back, Twitter twos. I didn't have anything else to say, so I said Twitter twos. I'm Nick Anthony. Right back.
I'm Nick Anthony.
XFL Now.
You're listening to XFL Now on Action VR Network. Do you want to capture the best memories you can? Is wanting to preserve those memories your goal? Do you want your memories to last a lifetime? Do you want your memories to look beautiful in pictures? Well, if you live in Southern Oregon or Northern California, there's one place that you can save those treasures for a lifetime. Grateful Heart Photography. Abigail Summers is your solution for capturing your favorite moments and memories like birthdays, graduations, weddings, family portraits, single shots, and more. She can also capture the finest scenery shots around and make them available all across the country and around the world at a price that can suit your budget. So if you're looking for the right photographer that can preserve your legacy, look no further than Abigail Summers at Grateful Heart Photography. Call Abby at 541-890-4657 or message her at her Facebook page by searching Grateful Heart Photography. Much of her work is displayed there. Feel grateful for the memories captured by Grateful Heart Photography.
This is our time. We play without limits. We create without rules. We are not for sale. We connect with the whole world. Every idea we've shaped, every relationship we've cultivated, belongs to us. We demand the freedom to be our uncensored selves. And when something challenges that, we change it. Together. This is our time.
One, two, three.
Let's start a revolution. Let's MeWe. Join the revolution at MeWe.com.
310-876-8064 is the telephone number. 310-876-8064. The way we consume our news has changed, Mike, over the years. Gone away are newspapers for the most part. Johnny Dallas at 5 is certainly not what we're waiting and watching for our sports news. We're too busy for that. And, of course, our ADHD doesn't help. So we go to the internet. We go to sites like XFLboard.com. We see the headlines and we decide if it's important enough for us to click or don't click. Here's something we call Weeks on the Week. Mike?
All right. Well, our first headline is the Spring League and its partnership with XFL and potentially partnering officially and becoming the XFL minor league. Click or no click?
I'm going to click on that. Mike, you're going to click on that? Or you don't care?
I'm clicking on that for sure.
All right, go ahead.
All right, basically this is the XFL and its partner, the Spring League, wrapped up its final summer showcase. This three-day event was the Spring League showcase for the XFL and potential rules testing in the 2020 season. According to a report on John Wall Street, the Spring League and XFL partnership has been a profitable one. Vince McMahon's Spring League is amongst TSL's biggest clients, having spent six figures on three mini-camp tryouts thus far. The report goes on to say that preliminary talks between Oliver Luck and TSL CEO Brian Woods could lead to a D-League of the XFL. The relationship, quote, the relationship between TSL and the XFL has gone so well that Woods said he's had preliminary discussions with Oliver about becoming the quote-unquote official D-League of the XFL.
All right.
That was per XFLNewsHub.com. I think that's a fantastic partnership, and it's clearly been working so far through the summer.
Yeah, no question about it. I agree with that. You know, it's interesting, though. It changes the dynamic because the way the Spring League is currently constituted, they have players that pay them to play in front of scouts from all leagues. A true developmental league would have actual games, venues, teams, that kind of deal. So I don't know if PSL wants to change their model. Obviously, they're happy with the relationship. The XFL is using them as a third party to help them scout players and test their game rules. So both sides are happy right now. And, you know, six figures, that sounds about right.
All right.
Yeah, and the only other thing from this is the next TSL showcase will take place from September 24th to September 25th. The XFL will only be scouting players. They won't be testing any rules at that one. The next one is, this is XFL related, I promise, or potentially XFL related. Quarterback Josh Johnson, the former number one overall pick of the AAF, turned down a deal with the Baltimore Ravens. Click or no click?
Ooh, yeah. What the hell is this issue?
I'm clicking.
Yeah.
Okay, the Baltimore Ravens were in a market for a backup quarterback because RG3 got hurt. Josh Johnson had a week's worth of tryouts, but turned down an opportunity to be with the Ravens. He's 32 years old and said, quote, "This is not the right opportunity at this time." It goes on to say that it's a bit odd that that any quarterback would turn down an NFL opportunity.
Weed.
But I feel that this was literally a deal where Josh Johnson left the AAF, put together a tape at the NFL, has not received any type of any type of interest from teams. This could be a situation where he actually wants to go to the XFL because he thinks he could be a starter at the XFL level.
I think that's very possible. I'm definitely clicking on this because obviously we started this conversation on XFLboard.com's message board.
Yeah.
Both the last two topics. So I would say with Josh Johnson, I think it's a possibility that you may not like it, but I think it's a possibility that he could be in the top tier, one of the eight top tier quarterbacks. I'm not saying that for sure, but I think he probably wants an opportunity where he's actually going to get on the field to play. You know, the funny thing with Josh Johnson is he's actually played with 13 different NFL teams.
Yes.
So and he played in the United Football League. So he was with the Sacramento Mountain Lions, if I'm not mistaken. So he's had a long career, and he's been a journeyman player. I've heard the XFL in interviews has been very complimentary. Eric Galco has been complimentary of Josh Johnson. Oliver Luck has mentioned him on more than one occasion. So I think it's possible he plays in the league. I wouldn't rule it out. He might be waiting for a better opportunity because the Ravens opportunity was something where he was going to be holding the seat warm until RG3 returns, and he's not going to beat out Trace McSorley for a roster spot. So I think he wants a more realistic opportunity to actually make a team rather than be cut 2 weeks in or cut right before camp, that kind of deal.
I'm going to take an opposite side of this story. When you have an NFL team that comes knocking on your door, you answer it. Otherwise, you get passed and left behind. Something tells me there's something more to this story, and it might be medical and or recreational, if you know what I mean.
Oh, interesting. All right. That's one avenue to take. There could be something to it. Who knows?
What else you got, Mike?
All right. Former Indianapolis Colt punter and overall character, Pat McAfee is going to be joining ESPN, as ESPN broke earlier this week. This does possibly have an XFL tie. Click or no click?
I don't care.
well, you know, I think it's click. I think you guys mentioned earlier, you know, Vince McMahon's propensity to micromanage and control things, where one of the things that was revealed in the LA Times article a couple months back was that Vince McMahon is ceding all control to the broadcast himself. So he will, something that he doesn't, you know, do with his own wrestling programming, he's not going to be producing the games. The networks are going to be hiring the talent. So I think Pat McAfee, who has a lot of supporters online, I think he's definitely a personality, no question about it. I think there's a very good chance he works for the league, especially if he's working for ESPN. He's going to be doing college football games. So I would say I'm not against it. It sounds like you guys might be. I'm not sure. But
I'm actually not against it at all. I love it. I think Pat McAfee is a perfect fit to be a color commentator for XFL games, especially on ESPN. I think it's a perfect fit. Nick, if you don't know who Pat McAfee is,
no.
Go look
him up. He's a college announcer. Listen.
Fantastic.
I can care either left, right, or in the center. It's not me, so the hell with it.
All right. There you go.
I'm Nick Anthony.
Fair enough.
Okay.
I'm Nick Anthony.
You got anything else?
No, those were the three topics for tonight.
All right, that's Click or No Click, Weeks on the Week. I think that's going to do it for us on the program. I want to thank Mike Mitchell, staff writer and reporter, even though he hung up on us in the last second. It's all good. Staff writer and reporter of XFLBoard.com. Go check them out over there. WON Sports, of course. AFNTalk.com is where you can find us. I'm BXB Nick on Twitter. Mike, you are where?
I am at MW Squared AFN Talk TLK on Twitter.
Thank you very much. That's going to do it for us.
You've been listening to XFL Now, which has been a production of the Alternative Football News Network and WON Sports. The executive producers for XFL Now are Harry M. Bob III, Nicholas Anthony, and Jonathan Rios. Find the XFL Now on social media at XFL Now Radio, like the Facebook page. XFL Now Radio. Follow us on Twitter. Stay up to date with the best in professional semi-pro, indoor, and arena football talk, and listen insightly for new and original alternative football talk at AFNN.net.
You're listening to the WON Radio Network.